we need to know that we're anchored firm, that we're not moved. We're not easily shaken. And this morning, we want to begin this conversation that we're going to have over the next 3 or 4 weeks, and we're going to have different people bringing the word in the next 3 or 4 weeks that will unpack the thought in different spheres. And today I want to talk to you about you. I want to talk to you about you and your individual person, and then the home that you create as an individual. And we're going to look at a passage of scripture in Matthew 7. And before we do that, let's pray. Father God, we thank you that you love to talk to your people. What a great God you are. And I ask, Lord God, that even as today we unpack your word, Lord, many of us have read this many times. And so today we need you, Holy Spirit, to breathe afresh, to highlight the areas in our life that we need to address, that we need to look at, that we need to make movement on. I ask, Lord God, that we would not be hearers, but we would be doers only, but doers of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you get your Bibles out, and would you turn to Matthew chapter 7? Go ahead, get out your devices and your Bibles, whatever you're using, and turn to Matthew chapter 7, and we're gonna go to verse 24. I've got it up here on the Amplified, so if you've got your YouVersion, change the version if you want, or we can read on the screen. It's the story of the two foundations that Jesus began to tell. And he says, this is Jesus talking. He said, "So everyone who hears these words of mine and acts on them will be like a wise man, a far-sighted, practical, and sensible man, who built his house on the rock, and the rain fell, and the floods and torrents came, and the winds blew and slammed against that house, yet it did not fall, because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish or a stupid man who built his house on the sand, and the rain fell, and the floods and torrents came, and the winds blew and slammed against that house, and it fell, and great and complete was its fall." This passage of scripture is written at the end of what is often called Jesus' inaugural sermon. It's the Sermon on the Mount. He preached it in Galilee. And I remember when we went to Galilee and they showed us this kind of little, wasn't a mountain, it was just like a little side. And the word mount wasn't necessarily in those days typical of a mountain, but it signified a point where the people would come and they would gather. And so he says, this is the Sermon on the Mount. This sermon in Matthew 5 begins with the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor. Blessed are the poor in spirit. But they will see, you know, and he goes on to describe this kingdom of God. If you've ever looked at the book of Matthew and you read commentaries on it, the book of Matthew is all about unpacking what is this kingdom? Why is the kingdom of God different to the kingdom of our current culture and our current world? It's different. And Jesus paints a picture in this sermon about the difference between his kingdom and his desire and the present state of play. And he ends his Sermon on the Mount with this parable. So he begins, I mean, if you read Matthew 5, 6, and 7, he goes and he talks about unforgiveness. He talks about not judging others. He talks about the golden rule. He talks about seeking first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto us in Matthew 6, 33. He goes on, he warns us to not listen to false prophets and not listen to people who come and sway us against the truth. There's a lot of warning in three chapters. And he ends it. So he's gone and he's made this huge, you know, be like seeing it. I mean, we just sat at Color Conference for 3 days. It's like sitting at Color Conference for 2 or 3 days and hearing the eloquence of the speakers and everything. And then Jesus finishes with this one story. It'd be like, you know, the speaker last night getting up and saying, "Right, you've heard all of these sermons, but here's the capstone. If you just hear his word and you don't do his word, then literally, not my words, but Jesus' words, you're stupid." The difference between a wise man and a foolish man was not that they didn't both build. I've been in church a long time, and I think in my head, I had kind of, even though I knew what the scripture said, I think I'd painted the picture like this for myself. That the wise man was the man who built his house on Christ, and the foolish man was the man that followed the world and did it the world's way. That is not exactly what your scripture says. Have a read. They both heard the word. They were both sitting in church. They both sat in church. They both rocked up. I mean, let's put it in our context. They both came on a Sunday morning. They both sat in the garage. They both came to here. They both came into the locker room. And they realized they needed to build. They realized there was something about their life that they needed to build and they needed to have shelter from. They realized storms would come. They realized rains would come. They realized things would happen in their world. And so they both built a house. They both realized that they had to build. They didn't have a choice. The message says it like this. These words I speak to you are not incidental additions to your life, homeowner improvements to your standard of living. They are foundational words, words to build a life on. And if you work these words into your life, you are like a smart carpenter who built his house on solid rock. Rain poured down, the river flooded, a tornado hit, but nothing moved that house. It was fixed to the rock. But if you just use my words in Bible studies and don't work them into your life. Hear me. If you just use these words in your Bible studies and in your life groups and in church, oh, that was nice. What a great talk that was. That was excellent. And you walk out and it doesn't affect the day to day. Then the Bible says you're like a stupid carpenter who built his house on a sandy beach. When a storm rolled in and the waves came up, it collapsed like a house of cards. That's the message paraphrase. There's a lot of similarities with these two guys. They both persevered. They both completed their house. Think about it. They both persevered. They both completed their house. They were equally well skilled to build. Listen. They were equally capable to build. It's not like having, you know, an amazing carpenter and then having a DIY specialist, okay? They both had the skill to build. Both houses stood for a time. The likeness between them is considerable. They were equally impressed with the need to build a house. They perceived that they were going to need shelter. They realized that one day it was going to rain and that they'd need an umbrella. They realized that one day storms of life were going to come and they were going to need protection. One builder is wise and one builder is foolish. Why? Because one is superficial and the other is substantial. One is pretentious and the other is sincere. Well, that's pretty harsh, Bet. It's not me. This is Jesus' own words. I began to think about these two houses and I began to think of it in light of my context. And 16 years ago, we built our house. And we drove up our street and decided that'd be a good place to live and bought our block of land. And we're not builders. We, you know, obviously contracted people to do the work on our behalf. That's what it looked like, empty. It's a vacant block of land. We knew that there was a need for us as a family and even us as individuals to find shelter. We knew that we were going to need protecting from the elements. Didn't you? Haven't you done that too? You've realized, hey, I need a house. These builders in this story realized they needed a house. The main difference between these two guys that are building is that one decided that he would build foundations and he would use solid material to build it on. The other one decided, I'm going to skip that process. Now, before you get too hard on the foolish man, think about you and I. We don't have a pergola. I'd like a pergola. We don't have a pergola. So, not Christian's fault. I just would like a pergola. But we decided to buy a gazebo, one of those gazebos. And it's a classic Beck kind of story, if you know me. We were having a party. I think we were doing a big party in our backyard, and I wanted Our backyard gets done whenever there's a party in the backyard. Is anyone else like that? And so we went and you know, did all that we need to. I got this pergola. I was really happy with the pergola. And anyway, started to rain really bad. We were out. And I'm thinking in my head, I really hope that pergola is okay. It was sturdy. It was, you know, cost us, you know, it wasn't like a cheap little, went and bought a good quality pergola. And, I mean, gazebo thingy. It was big. It was like 3 meters, you know, maybe 4x4. It was a huge kind of gazebo. Anyway, and I'd planned to string lights, and I'm thinking of the decorations, and of course, as you do, and you're planning a party. And so, anyway, the wind's really picked up. Anyone, like, lie in bed at night, and you hear the wind, and you think about your outdoor table, and your outdoor chairs, and you think, oh, I hope they're not blown away, I hope. And then, you know, the panic in you gets up and looks out the window just to check that they're not blowing away in the wind. Well, this was one of the worst nightmares, because we arrived home, and I remember at the time, Sarah and Chris and Essie were with us, and we arrived home from dinner, the kids, we arrived home from dinner, and we looked out the back, and there's no pergola. No, there's no gazebo. I said, Christian, there's no gazebo. Oh, there's a gazebo. I go, there's no gazebo. The party's in 7 days. There's no, anyway, by this stage, I'm not entirely calm in my, there's no gazebo. And anyway, Chris and Christian go out. The gazebo had literally, you know, we had not anchored it in. That's the moral of the story. But the gazebo, like the wind had lifted it up over the top of our house. It had kind of flown right over into the next door neighbor's house. The whole structure, the whole like kit and caboodle in next door neighbor's house. Anyway, we won't go into any other stories we may. Anyway, you don't need to know how we retrieved it. But we got the gazebo back. Literally, it was no longer intact. There was no option. This gazebo was not being used again. And so, of course, you know, I made Christian go, please, I need shelter for the party, and put a sage shell in and all the rest. But it reminded me of this story. We are not anchored in. We are not anchored in that silly little big gazebo. It looked pretty. It really did. And it would have looked lovely with my fairy lights, and I could picture the decorations that I'd planned to put in for the party. But it didn't stand the storm when the storm came. And so it was no use for the party. In fact, it was just a lot of outlay for nothing. It cost me a lot of work, and it didn't even stand the test of a little bit of wind. This is this guy. He has his structure. He's ready. His wife's ready. Well, okay, I'm not going to be sexist. Maybe he was ready to decorate. But when the winds came, and when the storms came, and when the floods came, it didn't stand. Why? Because it wasn't anchored in to anything of substance. And that gazebo, even though it had a steel frame and it had a nice canopy, it wasn't connected, it wasn't anchored, it wasn't plugged into anything that was stronger than itself. Are you plugged into anything that is stronger than you? Are you anchored into anything that is stronger than your finances? Are you anchored into anything that is stronger than the workplace that you're at now? Are you anchored into anything that is stronger than your family? Because all of those things can go in an instant. Oh, but Jesus, when you anchor into Jesus, he's the solid rock that doesn't change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. When you build your life on the solid rock, when you anchor in firm to the truth of who he is, nothing will be able to shake you. You'll be shaken, but won't be moved. You'll be pressed, but not crushed. That's his word. So how about you? Are you anchoring into anything that is stronger than yourself? That includes other people. You can try and anchor yourself to someone else. But if they're the same as you are, and we all are, we're fickle. We mess up. We're human. We need to connect. We need to anchor in. Dig down deep. Connect to Jesus. So we decided, well, actually Mervac, I think, at the time decided, that they would begin our building process with a foundation. This foolish man had no foundation. Here's what I can tell you. Without foundations, our house would have been a lot cheaper. Think about it. Without having to worry about marking it out, and I mean, many of you have built homes or you've seen structures being built. And without having to go through the hard foundational work, it's cheaper, it's quicker, but it doesn't last. I was thinking about the Christmas Wonderland that we used to build in there with gaffer tape and staples. And many of you laugh, but you know it's true. We had 2 weeks, 3 weeks of 1,000 people coming through our property and coming to that Christmas Wonderland experience, and it was held together with gaffer tape and staples. And after every time, the kids would come in and we'd go around gaffering, stapling, making sure that it was fine for the next week. It was fine. It didn't have to stand forever. It was only staying for 3 weeks, and then we were packing away. But that structure in there for our kids, that had to last for a long time. It was an investment. So yeah, it's cost money that we've all sown into and continue to, because we want it to last. We want it to be something that is that can withstand the weekly entourage that will fill its walls. So how about you? I was thinking, it's really easy to say, oh, I build my life on Jesus. But many of you would say, I build my life on Jesus because I attend church on Sunday. And Jesus is saying, actually, you don't. Hearing my words does not mean you're building your life on me. Hearing my words just means you heard my words. Building your life on me means you heard my words and you put them into practice. Building your life on me says you heard me say forgive, and so you took that thing in your heart that you wanted to hold on to and you went, God, I don't get it, but I will, because you said it, that settles it for me, and you work through the process of forgiving. It means that when Jesus says, seek first my kingdom and everything else will come when you seek, it means that you put him first. It means that his house is a priority. It means that in your house, his house matters. It means that his words aren't just accessories that you tack on to make yourself look good. His words aren't just like, oh, well, Jesus said that we should treat everyone with love, and he did say that. But if you're just using them to accessorize, if we're just using them to make ourselves look pretty, then really what we do is call ourselves hypocrites. Because the minute that the storm comes, and the minute that the waves hit, and the minute that the floods come, we're out of the picture. We can't stand any longer. I began to go, God, so how do we do that? How do you build Christ as the foundation of your life? Not just God is the foundation of my life. That's, I think, one part, declaring it. But how do I actually do it? You're here and you're a teenager here this morning. You're a single person. You're an older person. You're sitting here and you're going, okay, that's nice. I can see what you're saying. I need to build Jesus as the foundation of my life. That's nice. But how on earth do I do that? I'm so glad you asked. 1 Corinthians 3, 9 to 15 says it this way in the message. It says, you are God's house. Using the gift God gave me as a good architect, I designed blueprints. Apollos is putting up the walls. Let each carpenter who comes on the job, listen, take care to build on the foundation. Remember, there is only one foundation, the one already laid, Jesus Christ. Take particular care in picking out your building materials. Eventually, there's going to be an inspection. If you use cheap or inferior materials, you'll be found out. The inspection will be thorough and rigorous. You won't get by with a thing. If your work passes inspection, fine. If it doesn't, your part of the building will be torn out and started over. But you won't be torn out. You'll survive, but just barely. The problem is, just like I wanted my gazebo for my party, I wanted an instant pergola without the cost of building a pergola. We want the shortcut. We want the baked dinner in 20 minutes. We don't want to have to put it in the oven and slow roast it and have heat fill our house and have to smell it for 3 hours. We want it instant. We want the shortcut. We want a dream and then the magic just to appear. You know, we go to a conference like yesterday and we see the lights, we see everything. Yes, we want that, but we don't want to give to make sure that we have lighting and sound like that. Do you see what I'm saying? We want the furniture and we don't want to build the flat pack. Amen. Anyone else? We expect a thriving kids ministry, but we don't want to volunteer. We want the trimmings without the hard work. We want the Disney animation in real life. Don't we? We want the party without all the setup. Honestly, we do. We want to go to the party. We want it to be great. We want the flowers. We want everything beautiful. But we don't want to have to set it up. We don't want to have to do it. Are you kidding? And then the pack up. We don't want to pack it up. We don't want to pick up rubbish. And we don't want that kind of a... But it doesn't happen that way. It doesn't work that way. You know what? In Stanford University, one of the most famous universities in the world, there was a quadrangle. It's near San Francisco. In the quadrangle of Leland Stanford University, there stood a magnificent memorial arch. It was built so largely and solidly and splendidly, it seemed it would stand forever. But when the earthquake came, it collapsed in ruin. Its foundations were destroyed. The builder had put in... When they looked, instead of laying a proper foundation, the builder had put in chips and rubble in its place. Don't replace the hard work and the dedication and the time and the prayer and the fasting and the worship. Don't think you can replace that with just shoving on a worship CD and out we go. Hear me, church. If we're going to move forward, it's going to require a cost, and it requires us pressing in prayer and in fasting and in worship and in atmosphere and in love and in faith. It's going to require something of us. It requires us to put on our tool belt and to get our hammer and begin to build. But let's not miss building on the foundation. When I looked at these two guys, I thought there's one word that separates the two of them. And it's the word obedience. They both heard the word. They both heard it. And one of them let it, contained it within his ears. And the other let it go deep down to his heart. And he built on more than just head knowledge. He built on the solid rock. He factored in foundation. John 1:1 said Jesus was the word that became flesh and dwelt among us. The message says that Jesus came among us and moved into the neighborhood. Jesus is the living word. So where he says, will you obey my teaching? Will you obey my word? What's he saying? Will you obey me? I am the living word, he said. Will you follow my ways or will you go your way? So here we go. We're going to look at really quick five different aspects of this foundation. The very first part of the foundation process, on soil at least, was marking out and cutting the ground. Many of you are sitting here this morning and you've never surrendered your lives to Jesus. You've never cut the ground. And this morning, you can begin the building process of building your life on the solid rock by cutting the ground. By saying yes to Jesus, by surrendering your life to Him. Notice that it's just one part of the foundation process. It's the starting point. It's not the be and end all, it doesn't end there. Actually, the scripture says that you work out your salvation with fear and trembling. That you are saved as you are being saved. That one day as you meet Jesus face to face, that you'll know the completion of the salvation that is yours because you've put your faith in Jesus Christ. But if you're going to anchor into something that's stronger than you, then it starts with surrender, and surrender is coming and saying yes to Jesus. The second part of the... Let's go back. The second part of the process was that they framed it out. They marked it out with chalk line. They put pegs on all the corners. I know this because I document. I had time, obviously, then to document the whole process. And they dig down piers to find the rock. But they frame it out exactly the outside and the frame of the house. If you're taking notes this morning, number one, you build a foundation on Jesus by surrendering your life to Him. Number two, you build a foundation on Jesus by putting Him in your everyday life. It's not just an He's not just an accessory and a tack on for Sunday morning. It's not, God, I give you an hour and a half Sunday morning, and then the rest of the day, well, the rest of the week, we'll see how it pans out. Acts 17:28 says, in Him we live and move and have our being. In Him. Hidden in Him. Matthew 6:33, if we seek first the kingdom of God, all the other things will be added unto us. What does it look like for you to put Jesus in your everyday life? For me personally, it looks like committing to daily devotions. It looks like getting my Bible, my reading plan, and reading every day the Word of God. It looks like, as a mom, teaching my kids that this is a value to me. We have there's a very cool kids app called Keys for Kids, and it does a 5-minute devotional, and we're in the car for 40 minutes, and so every morning I put on the Keys for Kids app, and it has a key verse, and they have a scripture in it. We play that in the car, and we talk about it for maybe 2 minutes if we're lucky. And then we pray. But I realize that even as a parent, that my job is not just to put Jesus in my everyday life, but it's to make sure that I help my kids realize how they can put Jesus in their everyday lives. How will they know unless they're told? For me, this church and the body of Christ that we're a part of, they add to what we're already doing at home. It's not the church's responsibility to raise my kids in the ways of God. It's our responsibility as parents and as a family to raise our kids. And everything our amazing kids ministry brings is phenomenal, but it's an addition to what we're doing already. So mums and dads, grandpas, grandmas, aunties, anyone involved in a kid's life, you make a difference by the choices you make. Putting Jesus, I remember as a teenager, my grandmother, who's not here, so I can dob on her this morning, don't ring her or all you friends of hers, but she'd get in the car in the morning and she'd go, right, she'd drive me to the station, let's pray every morning. I'd be like, please look at the road as she's driving us to the station. And every morning she would pray and cover us as we were going to school. What does it do to my teenage heart? What does it do? It's putting Jesus in my everyday life. It's not just, well, Beck, we take you to church on Sunday and we drop you to youth on Friday. No, no, no. I'm putting Jesus in my everyday life. How about you? Those peers there in this photo, you can't see them. And I think that is the hardest thing about foundation. You can't see that they're there until the storms come. You can't see that they're there. I know Tony and Sarah had a choice, right, to build on sand. They're in an area with a lot of sand dunes, and so they could have built on sand. They decided, right, to dig down deep and to put piers in and find rock. I hope it's not rock, something, just to find piers. They decided to dig down deep and not just build on the surface in the natural, because they're in an area where, I mean, the sea's right there. So how about you? The scripture says that we're to dig down deep and root ourselves into the love of God. And when I think of those peers, I think about being rooted and grounded in God's love. Going deeper in God doesn't mean that you learn a new revelation or a new truth. It may, but it may not necessarily be the end of it. If a new revelation and a new truth does not drive you deeper into the love of God, then it's mere head knowledge. And that's nice for a time, but it's just accessory. I love a good, smart person. I love talking with them and whatever, but if it's just head knowledge and it never gets beyond just knowing a lot of information and it doesn't move to a deep understanding of the knowledge of God, it doesn't move to a love relationship with Jesus, then when the storms come and the rains hit and the floods come, you can't tell foundations are there until the storms hit. Anyway, so they're the peers. So putting Jesus in your everyday life and building on Christ, that foundation is making a choice to dig down deep into the truth of his love. And you know what his love says? His love said you're valued. His love says that you are his. His love says that nothing you do or say could ever separate you from the love of God. His love is wide and vast and immense, and you could never compare it. You could spend all eternity trying to grasp the beautiful love of God. I said to my music class this week, I said, if we were going to describe God's love, how would we describe it? And don't give me churchy words. If you were going to talk about God's love, how would you describe it? Crazy. It's crazy. So what do you mean crazy? Well, you know, it just doesn't make sense. Out of the mouth of babes. That God's love would reach us while we were yet sinners, while we were lost in sin, that his love would reach us whether we chose him or not, that he would demonstrate his love on a cross for us. We dig down deep into his love. Then they began to lay the slab. Begin to think about just the whole thought of concrete and rock. And for me, this concrete is his word. I said to a friend this week, I'm a creative person. I feel a lot of things. I love being around creative people. But because I'm made up that way, I have to choose to go by his word and not by how I feel a lot of the time. Because if I go on how I feel, I know that I'm making a decision that isn't necessarily in line with the word of God. And if I'm a woman in authority and a woman under authority that submits to Jesus and submits to my leaders with devotion and commitment, then I have to be a woman that is anchored and not a woman that is easily swayed. If only for the fact that I have three babies looking at whether my life is the real deal. They are. Does your life really measure up? His word in our home gets the first word and it gets the last word. 1 Peter 5:8-11 says, keep a cool head, stay alert. The devil is poised to pounce and would like nothing better than to catch you napping. Keep your guard up. You're not the only ones plunged into these hard times. It's the same with Christians all around the world. So keep a firm grip on faith. The suffering won't last forever. It won't be long before this generous God, who has great plans for us in Christ, eternal and glorious plans they are, will have you put together and on your feet for good. He gets the last word. Yes, he does. How about in your home, in your heart? Does your opinion get the last word? Or does Jesus get the last word? How about let's just take our mouth, what we say. Do you get the last word? Or does Jesus get the last word? Wow. Let's all just take a seat and Who gets the last say? When you want to have a hissy fit and go off, and who gets the last word? Who gets the final say? If we're building our lives on Jesus, then we come to him and say, Jesus, the last word is all yours. The first word is all yours. Lead me, guide me, direct me. I was thinking about Obed-Edom. I don't know if you know this story in 2 Samuel 6, but the Ark of the Covenant lands in his house. And for 3 months, the presence of Jesus, or the presence of God in the Ark of the Covenant, is residing in his house. And because it does, his house flourishes. Because it does, everyone notices the blessing of God. They notice the favor of God. When you build a house on solid foundation, the blessing and the favor of God comes on your life. Because when God makes himself at home in you, like Ephesians 3 says, when he makes him, and when he takes up residence in you, and he's given a say in terms of the foundation of your life. It's not just hearing. I'm not just hearing church is good. I'm hearing be planted. And I'm not just hearing I can know the love of God, but I'm hearing I need to be rooted and grounded and know who I am because of who he is. When you root and ground yourself in who Jesus is and not in who you are, what a security and a blessing that comes when you know you don't have to be tossed and thrown on every little whim. So the foundation goes in and the frame goes up and the bricks go on and all the beautiful accessories that you want on the inside eventually come. 16 years later, it was rainy, dark this morning when we left. This is our home. The worship team are going to come this morning. There has been many a night where the winds have picked up around our house. I'm only ever worried about the things that are not anchored down now. I worry about the outdoor table and the chairs there. But I don't worry about the things that I know that are anchored deep. And some of you, you've been in church a long time. And people think you're anchored deep. But they would have looked at the foolish man and thought that he was anchored deep too. They would have looked at him and thought, you know what? He's built a great house. That's amazing. Look, and he built it on sand. You could even imagine the props he would have got. Hi, you finished so much earlier than the other guy, and you built it cheaper than the other guy. You could imagine even the praise that he might have got. Until the storm comes and your world is rocked. Many of you are sitting here this morning and you could testify with a lot more authority even maybe than I could this morning that Jesus is surely an anchor to your soul. That when the storms have come and the troubles have hit, you thought that you would have been rocked. But you realized that when you hit rock bottom, because you'd built your life on Jesus, he was the rock. Do you hear me? Many of you have hit rock bottom, but when you hit it, Jesus was the rock. He was there. I've walked with many of you in hospital rooms. Walked with people just this week from our own church family who lost another loved one. And I'm amazed at the strength that many of you show in the face of your storm. And I'm reminded, you build a beautiful frame and a lovely home. Your life smells well and it reads well. But when the storms have come and everything's wanted to take you out, your peers have gone down deep into the truth of who he is. Here's the problem that we have. is that sometimes the storms that come and the trouble that hits rocks us so much that we want to rip up our piers. We want to rip up our foundation and we destroy all that we've built. Proverbs would say that a woman builds her home and with her own words she destroys it. We can spend years building a marriage and then with our own words bring cursing and bring destruction to our home. We can spend years investing in family and in friendships and then with our own words we can destroy them. We can spend years, many of us, investing into the life of our church, into the life of our church family. And without even a blink of an eye, we pull up roots and we speak words of death and destruction and we wonder, God. Would you stand this morning? I want to ask you a question. This morning is how we're going to finish. I want to ask you, where are you in this? And to read all that Jesus is talking about, you would have to go and read Matthew 5, 6, and 7. And I think if you read that every day for the rest of your life, and that was even, maybe even in terms of scripture, that was what you read, it would be enough to challenge you and to make you follow hard after him. Sarah was telling me, we were chatting over this and I was quizzing her about the sand and the piers. And anyone who builds a house knows the frustration of how long it takes. Because you just want it built already. And some of us, we just want to be over this already. And we want to have fixed this bit already. And we wanted to have moved past some of this stuff that we're having to walk through. We want to be able to have solved this already. And the time is driving us nuts. Frustrating. She was saying to me, Beck, the interesting thing is that when the slab and the concrete is laid, many of you know, they have to let it cure. And for them, it was watering the slab so that cracks didn't appear. What a picture. That if Jesus is our foundation, that the Spirit of God would come and water the truth of who he is in our lives, compacting it down. I would love to stand before you this morning and say, you know what, guys? We're going to have a great year. Nothing's ever going to happen to rock your boat. I can't do that. Jesus didn't do that. But what I can say to you is this. There's a solid foundation that if you build your life on Jesus, when you put him in your everyday life, it's not just an accessory. When you dig down deep into the love of God, when you give his word priority in your life, when you say, Jesus, you said it, that is enough for me. You don't need to convince me any further. If your word says follow you, then I'll follow you. And if your word says I'm obedient, I'm putting my trust into action. I want to open the altar this morning. I feel like when I was preparing this, that there are people that you know, your life looks pretty. Anyone would think that you have built your life on the foundation, but you know that there's some foundation work to happen. And here's how you know. Cracks have appeared in the walls and you've got the builder out to repair the wall. And then 6 months later, the cracks come back. So you get the paint out and you paint over the crack. And then 6 months later, the crack appears again. You're like, hey, I dealt with that crack 5 times. And you get the builder out and he says, oh, it's not a wall issue. It's a foundation issue. That because the foundation is moving, the cracks are appearing. I would be the first to say that I have cracks appearing in my life regularly, that I have to go back to King Jesus, my foundation, and say, oh, do a work in me. Do a work in me. Keep me strong, Jesus. Keep me grounded. I want out of this. I want to pull it all up. And God says, no. Dig down deep. Get on the solid ground. I want you to come and do business with Jesus this morning. Maybe you're here this morning and you're like, you know what? I built my life on Jesus. But I know that there's some things I need to do. He's been talking to me this morning. There's areas that my words are bigger than my life. And this morning, I want you to do business with God. I present this word to you this morning with a warning. You've been instructed this morning to not just be hearers of the word, but to be doers. And so I want to ask you this morning, what will you do now that you know?